Y'all set?
Yep.
Okie dokie. Hey, how's it going? I'm Samson Folk, co-host of this wonderful podcast, Bouncing Around, that is so graciously co-hosted and fully hosted by M. Gualberto on his YouTube channel of the same name, through which he has put blood, sweat, and tears into building it. It's magnificent. Look around you. The ambiance. Wow. But, as I said, bouncing around, that's what we like to do here at this basketball podcast, league-wide, bounce around. He walks away, the sun goes down, he takes the day, but I'm grown, and in your way, in this blue shade, my tears dry on their own. Okay, Evin. First things first, I know we like to kind of get lost in the minutiae of basketball, as we are wont to do, but this week, something so big happened in the basketball stratosphere. James Harden traded to the Brooklyn Nets. I'll get to that in a second. First of all, how are you?
I'm good. I'm like that super popular thing floating around now where it looks like James Harden lost 50 pounds in a week after getting traded. I'm that good. That's how good I am. How are you?
I mean, can you tell by the hat? A guy who is down does not wear this hat.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like I've heard you. The Raptors have won two straight. They're on a tear. So I know you're in good spirits.
Yes, wins against not only the Hornets twice, but the Kings, the Knicks, and forcing the, at that point in time, the Knicks were the best shooting team in the NBA from downtown. And they shot 3 for 36 against the Raptors. And it has completely thrown every defensive metric out of whack for Pascal Siakam, because that was the game he missed. So now Aaron Baines is like a world-ending defensive presence. Mm. And Pascal Siakam is like, is this guy the worst defender on the Raptors? And that's why you watch the games, folks. Which we do. So I happened to watch the first half unimpeded of Brooklyn-Orlando, James Harden's first game. Soon after that, the Raptors game started. It's my job. Right. I have to cover the game. Did you watch that game?
I checked in on it from time to time. Yes. I watched it in chunks.
Okay. In chunks. Perfect. Because that's technically how I did it too. Revisiting the second half afterwards. Initial takeaways from James Harden and Kevin Durant running wild in Brooklyn. Thoughts?
So James Harden, Kevin Durant, there's nothing you can do. The two of them sneak up on nobody. They're both former MVPs, scoring champions, etc. There's nothing on earth a defense can do against them. So, I don't know. What are your thoughts?
So, my initial takeaway for James Harden and Kevin Durant is that it's very clear Kevin Durant, a man who, even when you're covering him, you have a hand in his face, you're not really covering him. That guy, who's also top 10 in true shooting percentage in the league, as a voluminous wing scorer, that guy is about to get way more open shots. Now, is that crazy? Yes, because Kevin Durant not only has looked offensively like the same type of shot maker as prior to his Achilles tear. Now, I don't know about the driving in his game. There's been scenarios where he hasn't been able to turn the corner, help side defense, kind of bouncing off of that plant foot, getting over for a contest late. You can see the effects there. Shooting, this guy's a heat pump. Nothing stops him. And James Harden is so, the gravity he has coming downhill, going to the sideline, walking the ball backwards to half and sizing up. The whole team is like, what's he going to do? And Kevin Durant suddenly being able to just kind of wade into wide open shots, that's a problem for the league. That's a big problem. And teams will constantly have to parry back and forth between how do we want to play these guys? And my spicy prediction, James Harden has shot over 70% at the rim once in his career. It was his third year in OKC. Last year playing with Kevin Durant, as it were, I believe. Right? He did 3 years in OKC, and then he went to Houston. If I'm wrong, I'll put it up on the screen. Okay. He's going to shoot 70% at the rim this year. James Harden is the amount of defensive attention that teams won't be able to give to him. I don't know how much the three-point shot is going to come around. James Harden still wasn't moving off ball at all. And if they want to win against the Lakers, that'll probably be important. But my God, the amount of space he has to just walk to the bucket, it's too much. And they don't even have Kyrie yet. And Joe Harris, I mean, I was listening to Kevin O'Connor and Chris Vernon. I know Kevin O'Connor is like a bit of a meme, but I think he's good at his job. And Chris Vernon is like a shock jock guy, you know, really raspy voice. He's going to talk about clutch, and I don't like this guy, and I don't like that guy. And he was like, Joe Harris isn't going to touch the ball, KOC. What are you talking about? And Joe Harris put up like 7 three-pointers in the first quarter. And I was like, oh, God. This team invented the term spacing 300 years out from now. And you're like, what is spacing in basketball? They look at this team as the genesis of it. And Kyrie's not back yet. I'm going to watch as much Brooklyn as I can this year. And if I can, next year if there's fans, I'm going to any Brooklyn game I can muster. What a team. They're so fun.
I mean, this is the thing that we talked about off the pod is, are they going to have issues defensively? The answer for the first game, first impressions, is DeAndre Jordan is like, whatever. But there's a reason. If you're just going to look at the box score, I think he had 30 something points on, I think, 14 for 21, something like that shooting. I should pull it up. I should be more professional. But it looked easy and comfortable for Vucevic. That's Vucevic, however it's pronounced.
Vooch. Just call him Vooch, his nickname, and just ignore everything.
Yep. It was easy for him. And you have to think, if you're thinking about it in the future, I don't know if Bam is going to give you problems like that, but I can imagine there's a certain reigning MVP and a certain looks to be the MVP of this season out in the East that's going to give you major problems if you're Brooklyn, if that's how opposing centers can just do what they want to do to you.
Okay, so first thing, DeAndre Jordan, and this is he's washed. I can't believe he gets paid like $10 million because he's definitely washed. He still has value on the court, though, I think. He's a smarter decision maker than a lot of big men. So the aspect of if we get into the playoffs and DeAndre Jordan has the ball, he's not going to just fumble it away, ideally. And he'll probably save some of those passes that he was slipping the dimes into his pocket. Maybe save those for regular season matches. Let James, let Kyrie, let KD do their thing. Defensively, though, Vooch, I am friends with a staunch Vooch supporter, Anna Jane Smith 4 on Twitter. She was very happy with his game. That was a really good Vooch game, not only with how he approached it, but with, you know, how Brooklyn was unable to kind of meet him with the proper amount of resistance. Vooch is underrated. Embiid is a better offensive player than Vooch, not by a super significant degree, though. Embiid, I think, is like big-time defense. As it currently stands, if Philly doesn't add anybody, I don't think Embiid swings that series back into Philly's way. Now, if there's a point guard out in North Philly that makes his way back there, then Philadelphia gets really interesting. But as it currently stands, I think the Nets have made a trade to become the top dogs in the East. And, you know, maybe the NBA, depending on how much they can synergize that trio up top.
So much to unpack there. Just so the thing about it, like I said, we talked about it off the pod, is anybody going to be able to stop them offensively enough for, let's say Joel Embiid has an incredibly dominant series. That's still not going to be enough firepower. even if he has an incredible defensive series, that's he's not going to be able to stop enough shots to win them that series. So that's the thing about Brooklyn, is it doesn't really matter what you do offensively, or rather what you can't do offensively, defensively, you just don't have enough. That's it. You talk about spacing. You talk about Joe Harris. Joe Harris could win you a game by himself because he's a phenomenal shooter who is able to throw shots. Like, it's just, it's going to feel like pop a shot to him. It's just going to be easy. It's going to be easy for everybody else. If Brooklyn makes no moves right now to add to defend that center position, they're still incredibly dangerous on all levels.
What is the pitfall? Like, what, your coach, I love doing this to you because it's, hey, stop the best players in the world, Evan. Maybe that's the segment name. There's the graphic. You're looking at it. You're the coach. What are you looking to do? KD, actually, let's do this. James Harden on ball. KD setting the screen. Pick and roll. You can pick any two defenders in the world to guard it. But the guys, the other three defenders are James Ennis, Jayson Tate, and Kim Birch, okay? And you can have two guys to guard the pick and roll, but it's Jayson Tate, James Ennis, and Kim Birch guarding the rest of the action. What are you doing to stop it?
I hate this. No, but... So the only thing, the thing that jumps to mind is you try to corral them into a contested two. I don't really care how you do it. That's the result you want to live with. I know for KD, that's practically automatic. I know for Kyrie, that's practically automatic. James, practically automatic. But do you want to put your best defenders in foul trouble? That's not ideal. Maybe if they don't bring you anything offensively, okay, fine. But these guys are going to get their numbers. All you can hope to do is contain them enough to make it difficult enough. So force them into contested long twos. That's, and then pray. That's it.
So if we're looking at the floor, the things you don't want is the spray pass to the corner of the court. You don't want the pocket pass to the roll. You don't want a lob. You don't want a slip to open three-point space. You don't want Harden to get the lane. And you don't want Harden to get a switch or KD to get a switch. And it's really hard to control pick and roll possessions that much. There's a lot of different outcomes depending on what, just based on how the guy who's getting screened, the type of contact he makes at first, should, in a good defense, change how the defender is playing the guy coming over the top. It should be that kind of synergy. The Nets, in that play type, James and KD, just like, there's so many things that they can do. But I do think you're right, is you try and incentivize a worse shot than they could get and see if they take it. And if they do, contested to the best of your ability. And anything else is just like maybe a little bit too optimistic for how to guard those two players in conjunction with one another.
As I always say, it's about what you're willing to live with. And if the answer is anything outside of contested twos, then you can't win that, because Kyrie can get to the rim. James can get to the rim. Joe Harris, actually, solid when he's around the rim. So you have the type of activity and energy that Brooklyn seemed to have in game one. Again, it's only game one, and it is the Orlando Magic without Jonathan Isaac, the ideal defender, without Markelle Fultz, right? So you take those plus defenders away, and that messes with your scheme, but Brooklyn's going to do this to everybody. It's about, okay, are we going to blitz? That's not great. They're all great passers. If you switch, Karl-Anthony, poor Karl-Anthony, met Karl-Anthony. He's such a good dude, and he works so hard. One of the early – when I tuned in, Karl-Anthony was defending James Harden. He looked like he's doing well. Kevin Durant goes to set a screen. Cole fights over the screen, but he's not able to, and it's a switch. And Karl-Anthony's super athletic. He's a freak. But Kevin Durant just, like, launched over him like he wasn't there. There's nothing you can do. Just hope to contain. That's it.
Hope to contain. A motto for not only facing the Brooklyn Nets, but the world over the past year. Just hope to contain and doing an abysmal job at it. And I assume, or I project, that a lot of teams will also do that for KD and James. And Kyrie for whenever he comes back. And yeah, Kyrie, that whole thing. Hope he comes back. I hope he enjoys himself. I hope he's doing all right. Okay, game of the week. Evan, dangerously close to yours being postponed. The second iteration of it was. And I believe I told you to watch the first round. So I guess we lucked out. Karl-Anthony Towns, wow. That's like the most disheartening news I think anybody could have had, as far as you could a guy in the NBA, publicly, as far as we know, the most affected person from COVID-19, and maybe the most that I've heard of anybody. The amount of people he's lost that have had complications, tragic, and now he has it. Terrible. But your game of the week was the game he played in against the Memphis Grizzlies. Timberwolves, Grizz. And John Morant wasn't there either, but yeah.
No. Hard to talk about basketball when, you know, Kat is going through what he's going through. If you pray prayers up to him, you know, it's a complicated situation. But if we're talking about the game, he had a great game. Malik Beasley. Let's talk about Malik Beasley. He was the leading scorer for the Wolves. The Wolves lost that game. But Malik Beasley, it felt like, and I have a couple of clips strung together, it felt like he ran about 1,000 give and goes last game. He was throwing that ball. He was giving it up, and he was making a quick move, getting it right back. The dude looked like he was getting downhill with ease based on just give it up, attack space. It's a great thing that I think Ryan Saunders has done, is he gets that 4-out, 1-in or 5-out, and they're just attacking space. Ricky Rubio, not a great scoring game. His unselfishness, obviously, is well documented. But I think D'Lo, Cat, Rubio being the leaders of that team has, and of course Ryan Saunders, as I continue to say, is doing a great job given what he's had so far, is generating that space so everyone can just give and go and cut and attack and dive. And, you know, now that Kat's out, who knows what it's going to look like. They're going to continue to struggle again. But with Kat in, you can see how good it could be. And we talked about this in the preview pods. It's just guys like Wancho, Anthony Edwards, Malik Beasley, they can just do so many things without the ball. And D'Lo, Rubio, Kat are just so good passing the ball that it gets infectious and you just start to do extra. It's kind of reminding me, that game reminded me a little of like early Denver with Jokic when he has the ball. Guys are just willing to cut harder knowing that the ball is going to end up in their hands in positions to succeed.
The Timberwolves play the brand of basketball when they're going good that is the hardest to emulate on NBA 2K. You cannot attack space in NBA 2K. Everything is about beating a guy one-on-one, clearing out the weak side, and hitting threes. The Timberwolves, it goes from cramped to open really fast. Right. And that is Malik Beasley is really good, as you say, at operating in that type of universe where it's like it's these close plays, dribble handoffs, give and goes, where it's that the slow pacing and then the explosion, like bam, into the space. I love guys who can do that. The Timberwolves, if everybody on the roster starts to, you know, move through those plays with that much nuance, that much explosion, they will. They will be an early iteration of the Nuggets. Will they have as much, you know, ceiling? Probably not, because, you know, Cat has a ways to go defensively. He's still, even though there's clearly so much talent for passing there, and he's not afraid to pass, but there's still tons of stuff that needs to be worked into. They need to completely switch over the offense into doing that. Everybody needs to be familiar with it, not just Malik, not just Edwards on the, you know, the every other play. And then Rubio trying to work himself in wherever that fits. D'Lo, if they're not good this year and they're not good next year, the who knows what that means for his career and what type of role he's in. But as you say, I mean, just the passing, the type of style he plays, I think is so much fun. Just watching him go in, and I think to start that game, he's like 5 of 5 from the field, just mid-range, 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 mid-range. I love guys working like that because it's so much fun to see a guy kind of wiggle into space, get his jumper up, keep it moving like that. But, yeah, I watched some of that game, but I'm glad I have your opinion. On the Grizzlies side, what should I know about that team? How do they operate in this one?
If you weren't really paying attention, Memphis looked like they were in transition or early offense all the time. They just looked like they were getting downhill, running off, pushing off of makes and misses. You would think Ja Morant was in the game and not Kyle Anderson, slow-mo. They just went. And credit to Taylor Jenkins. Memphis played well last year, obviously. Almost would have made the playoffs were it not for that play-in. But Taylor Jenkins has them playing aggressive on both ends. It looks like they had a bunch of traps that were they definitely looked by design, but they almost came out of nowhere. And if Minnesota didn't have the type of passers, as I talked about, that they had, they would have been in a lot of trouble. And, I mean, as such, the Grizzlies won that game. They look aggressive on both ends in terms of attacking the ball and making lesser guys make decisions. And in terms of, it doesn't matter who you are. Valanciunas, you're running down the floor. Dylan Brooks, who has literally all of the confidence in the world. Dylan Brooks is pushing. Jones is like, everybody is just go, go, go. And Xavier Tillman, he looks so solid. He looks like so much fun. But all of those dudes are just, it looks like they're trying to just ram it down your throat with how fast they are going and how like eager they are to attack you offensively and defensively.
The Grizzlies picked two guys I really liked in the draft, both after the Raptors picked Desmond Bane, Xavier Tillman. They both look great so far as what they're providing. Desmond Bane, he's got the short arms. He can stroke it, and he's an aggressive defender. Xavier Tillman, I mean, he's not a defensive savant, but the people who liked him said, this guy's going to come in right away, and he's going to defend his position and others at a high level. He's so long. He's so disruptive. And I love disruptive big men. Guy like Alex Len, guy like Rudy Gobert. Of course, those aren't equal, but anyway. Guys who are really dominant at the rim. Those are fun. I enjoy the big men who are kind of working their way around the paint all the time. And if a guy's cutting in and there's a pass, it's whap, heavy hands. Guys who are very good at the little shovel pass. Their hand gets from here down to their hip to block it away all the time. Guys who get the kicked ball violations because they just won't surrender the pass. They're like, not, you're going out, side out. That's how I'm going to play defense. Xavier Tillman has all that. He loves the way I love the way he plays defense. He makes me really excited and really jealous that he's not on the Raptors, who have a very imbalanced roster currently. Love the Grizzlies. Love what they've been doing. And the Timberwolves. Unfortunately, both teams struggling mightily with their health. Here's the thing, though. You mentioned Dylan Brooks. What are your thoughts on him? Because I love the guy. His defense is so, there's so much energy to what he's doing. And the pull-up, man. This guy just hoists. If you were coaching Dylan Brooks, what would you tell him? What would you say to this guy if you wanted to get the most out of him?
There's not a thing you could say to Dylan Brooks. he doesn't need you. He doesn't need anybody, man. So here's the thing. Before the bubble, I was putting together a Dylan Brooks video. Why? Because he played so confident and he had me going to the point that I was just like, man, this dude is so much fun. He could score in any kind of way. And then I stopped and thought about it. And then I was like, what am I doing? There are a bunch of other guys like I would rather, you know, focus my time on. But Dylan Brooks almost got a video from me. And, you know, if he reaches out, I doubt he will. But if he reaches out, I'll come up with that video. He's just a guy who, that energy is infectious. He's a guy who, if you're dead in the water and you don't think you have anything going tonight, Dylan Brooks is going to be like, F it. I'm going to get a bucket. I'm going to drag this team along and we are going to get out of here. It's going to be competitive or we're going to steal a win. That's what it is. And I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it whether the coach lets me or not.
There is something to be said about how important volume scorers are to back end of the playoff type teams, borderline teams. Not everybody has the luxury to work with KD and Harden. Not everybody has Kawhi. Not everybody has these players that have really gamed the system that they're always going to give you just heaps of efficient points. The Raptors, for example, probably would benefit a lot from a volume scorer on their roster. Norman Powell, typically a volume scorer, has not been, and they sorely miss that. Just even if it's 42% from the field, come in and put some points up. Dylan Brooks fits that Grizzlies roster, this rendition of it, so well because he is the volume scorer on that team. Ja will ascend. Jaren Jackson Jr. will come back. Everybody will start to get healthy. Dylan Brooks, it'll be on him to transition into something more tenable. But as it currently stands, he's so important to their offense. And he's a good defender. So I like him. Any other notes on Memphis and Minnesota?
Yeah. So I want to talk about this one set, and I have the clip. I have it ready. It's actually Dylan Brooks, his willingness to set good screens. So Dylan Brooks enters the ball into slow-mo in the post, Brandon Clark and Dylan Brooks post split. Dylan Brooks goes all the way over to the weak side block and he just bodies Cat. He like shovels, like throws his chest, his arms into Cat's chest, and Cat gets hung up. As Valanciunas uses that as a cross screen. A post split into a cross screen for Valanciunas. It's the only thing I had in my notes, triple underline. You have to talk about this. It was so good, man. It was so good.
Do you think you'll ever get into taking notes on a computer or always by hand?
Always by hand. My partner was kind enough to get me a notebook that is erasable. It's also one of those notebooks where you scan, you take a picture and it scans it through. So I now have that luxury. So I like the feel of writing things down. Just like Brooks likes the feel of just bodying Karl-Anthony Towns, you know, so.
Okay. My game of the week, Pacers. Warriors, a very fun one, particularly in the middle of the fourth quarter when the shot making got like a little bit nutty, a lot nutty, just back and forth. First thing I want to touch on, the Pacers won, not because of Aaron Holiday, but because of Aaron Holiday. He was so freaking good. They spammed pick and roll with Aaron Holiday, be it with Miles Turner or Domantas Sabonis. They spammed him on ball for the last 4 minutes of the game and then just completely broke away from a dead tie that they've been going back and forth, and then they just won. Aaron Holiday was snaking to the bucket, making contact layups over Draymond, hitting threes, spraying the pass across to the corner, above the break, finding guys on the short roll, getting all the way to the rim, drop-offs, 16 points, 12 assists. Hell yeah, dude. I thought he was so much fun. And Brogdon was obviously Curry's primary when Brogdon was on the floor. But Holiday is no slouch defensively either. And I thought he made great, great contributions to the defense on Curry as far as when they were, when he was on the floor and matched up with him. They did such a good job of taking Curry, who's so dangerous, and funneling him into Miles Turner. And not only that, the back end, guys like Justin Holiday, Domantas Sabonis, Doug McDermott even, they're such a disciplined team that when Miles Turner's popping out, they protect the dunker spot really well. Now, when it was Draymond short rolling, the lobs did open up for James Wiseman. That was something that the Pacers had to say, okay, this is something they're going to get. But I thought the defensive scheme was so great from the Pacers in this one. They played awesome, outfoxed the Warriors, and that was even with the Warriors playing a decent game, getting a lot of, you know, good contributions from Kelly Oubre, from Wiggins. And Wiggins, oof, I don't know how to go to order this commentary because, okay, Wiggins was great too. He continues his great run of form defensively. He's gotten so good at using his length, not being overzealous. You bump him on the drive, he's still going to hold you to your line or maybe get you off of it, but you're not going to cut in straight to the bucket. And then if you want to go up, he's there. He'll meet you at the apex. He's long, quick jump, a lot of bounce. He's been so rangy this year defensively. Had a great game against Kawhi a few games ago. That's been carrying over. Good games against Pascal, stuff like that. And against the Pacers as well. Sumner. Edmund Sumner, I thought, was super fun. He doesn't always give you a lot when he's playing with the Pacers, but punched a lot of gaps. Finished at the rim. A lot of difficult finishes. Not Keldon Johnson level, but very, very fun. I enjoyed it. Steph, underwhelming game from him, but I just want to take the moment to say his throw-ahead dribble is like my favorite thing about him. Aside from the shooting, of course. The shooting's great, but Steph's throw-ahead is so good because it incorporates so many advantages of his game, so many of his great attributes is that throw-ahead pass. It's just way outside the sphere of his body because so many guys will fly by or they'll ride his hip. And if you ride Steph's hip, he's just going to do that little throw-ahead straight into open space pass. And then he's just so good. He'll just take it in his hand and the hezzy is right there if he wants to beat the big man or if he wants to dump off to a guy sneaking into the dunker spot, whatever he wants to do. Or he can just pull up right from there. I love that move from Steph. What else? Miles Turner, he was great, spacing the floor, rim protection, 6 blocks. Draymond had 10 assists. His ability to playmake from a standstill as they run sets and while on the move as he moves through stuff. Like there's this one play, he gets the ball on the short roll, passes out to the corner, sees the strong side defender and seals that guy after he makes the pass. And you're just watching a guy moving through the defense, making play after play that doesn't show up on the stat sheet because that's not an assist. I don't even know if it'd be a screen assist because it was so sneaky and it wasn't like in a primary or in a predictive screen scenario. who's to say? But there's just a lot of fun stuff that went on in this game. Brogdon, watching him run the pick and roll with Sabonis, super fun. I think he was 5 for 18 from the field. It wasn't super great, but anytime you can watch a Sabonis Brogdon pick and roll just for like pace and shiftiness, even if they don't score, do it. You might learn something. Pacers win. They had more depth. They had a really good game plan for the Warriors. My son is also named Bjork. Great stuff from Nate Bjorkgren. And as Evan says, anytime he talks about the Pacers, read Caitlin Cooper, because I do as well. And she can cover the Pacers basically like nobody I've seen. So Pacers and Warriors, that's how I feel about that game.
So Miles Turner, so I looked this up just because I've been kind of blown away with his defensive player of the year level play so far. Not to say that blocks mean anything defensively. You know, Hassan Whiteside, historically a great shot blocking numbers guy, but is he a good defender? I wouldn't say so. So Miles Turner has 4 games already with 5 or more blocks. 2 8 block games so far. The year before, Nate McMillan's final year, Miles Turner had 5 games in total of 5 or more. So Miles Turner, he's become, if he is a space the floor and block shots defender, a 3-and-D big, is that a thing? Might be a thing for him. He's very good at affecting the game. And Domas, man, if he's going to go for, 5-6 assists a game, Jokic East, I think you called him once a skinny Jokic. You called him once upon a time, many pods ago. The Pacers are so much fun. You talked about Edmund Sumner, skinny Edmund Sumner. He's good. If you haven't been watching the Pacers, now is the time. And take this moment to talk about the unfortunate situation with Caris LeVert. You know, I thought he could have really helped that team. This team is playing without TJ Warren and Caris LeVert, and they are doing the stuff they've been doing. Like, when those two guys come back, you're assuming if they come back healthy, you can, and Nate incorporates them, they're going to be a very, very fun team to watch. And there's so many different things they do defensively that they're worth your league pass viewing.
Just to touch on, before we get out of here, just touch on the defensive playmaking aspect. That is something that is super fun to watch. Stocks, steals, blocks. There is not that much collinearity between defensive playmaking and defensive value. Now, the very best defensive players will give you both. But historically, don't fall in love with block numbers. Don't fall in love with steal numbers. As Evan says, though, Miles Turner has been so much more defensively, the range. And if he is the 3-and-D big, whereas Fred VanVleet was the 3-and-D small when he was playing in the finals against Steph Curry, I mean, there's room for those guys. They don't just have to be on the wing. You're not just looking at Trevor Ariza. You could be 3-and-D anywhere. And if you're a kid listening, if you can handle the ball that well, keep working. But if your team needs a 3-and-D and you're 7 feet, I mean, hey, you're probably going to the NBA. You're a 7-foot kid. Keep working. Hoist those shots up. Play some defense. But, yeah. And as far as Sabonis is the son of everything that the Pacers do, they run a million actions through him every game, screening, passing, scoring, rebounding, defending. He's doing it all right now, and basically all of it at a high level. The Warriors sold out to stop him, and shooters became open. People found space off of his gravity, and they beat the Warriors. The Pacers are damn good. They are damn good. And yeah, that's my takeaway from that game.
Yeah, and I just have it in my notes. Andrew Wiggins, just want to quickly touch on him. I think he had like 4 blocks. Andrew
five.
Wiggins,
five.
Five. Five blocks. Excuse me, five blocks. again, not the end all defensive stat, but Wiggins being able to, maybe he always exerted effort. It didn't look like it to me, but let's just assume he always gives great effort. Having Kerr and his staff use that effort more productively, let's say, is really working out for him. And if I can talk about his pick and roll decision making, it looks crisp. It looks better. Is it better? It looks better to me. He looks more engaged. He looks like he's making crisp, smart decisions. And is this the Andrew Wiggins that we know anymore? What happened to him? It doesn't, he still looks the same, but it looks like just he's cleaned up the low hanging fruit. And maybe he could turn the corner and be a productive NBA player.
I said this could happen. And you said that you weren't going to do it again. And I said, oh, my sweet Canadian boy, I'm just going to stick with you for this season. I believe in you. You just got to play a little defense, Andrew, there, my boy. And you know what? We're going to find a winning team. And you're going to play a good role. And there he is. Andrew Colin Farrell Wiggins. That's the Irish in him. He's fighting Irish, fighting over screens, fighting to block shots. It's a weak analogy, I know, but we'll run with it.
It cut out there. It's a weak analogy, and then it just cut out.
That's fine. Okay. It's a weak analogy. Okay, Evan, your game of the week, sir. I'm going to give it to you now, and it's one I'm very interested to hear your thoughts on. Lakers, Bucks, Thursday night, 7:30 Eastern. Be there or be square. Giannis versus LeBron, AD versus his equal, Drew Holiday. Okay.
His New Orleans former compatriot. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. My game of the week for you should be fun. It's Shea and Dort versus Paul George, Kawhi Leonard, Thunder Clippers.
Another equal pairing.
Yep.
Equal footing in the league.
Perfect. Definitely the same.
Paul George also basically even par true shooting percentage with Kevin Durant. He's been slept on this year. I'm excited to see how he plays. I hope Dort is his cover. Fingers crossed. Because I don't want to watch Kawhi and Dort. I want to watch Paul George and Dort. Because Paul George can't like bump and hit over Dort. Kawhi will be able to. I want to watch Paul try and get away from Dort. Like, he's a very slithery player. And Dort is just like this fire hydrant being dragged behind a really powerful truck, smashing mailboxes and like garages and other cars. And yeah, I'm excited to see that. So thank you for picking that game. I'm absolutely enthralled.
And the reason I picked that game too is because nobody's going to talk about them. They're not as interesting as I would like. But the Thunder have been slept on. I'm not saying they're good, but they're entertaining as hell to watch.
That's right. Okay. As we've gone long on basically every episode, what I've done this time is I've scheduled a radio interview for right after we finish recording so that we don't go over. That's coming up in like 5 minutes. So, Evan, my guy, thank you so much for doing this with me. Another bouncing around episode in the books. What do you think?
I think we're finding a groove, man. I think we are going to get rolling. And as the season starts to become a little bit of a grind, we're going to find our groove and just going to go on that 8-game winning streak that nobody is expecting, sneak into the play-in. It's going to be us.
Grinding and grooving. Perfect. Evan, it's been an absolute blast. Listener, thanks for tuning in. See ya.
Stay safe, guys. Hey!